Hello friends, in this lecture we will see evaluation of machine learning algorithm and cross-validation technique. So before this we have seen that what are different types of learnings are there, and for that learning we have to apply different algorithms over there. So once you have defined your problem and prepared your data, you need to apply machine learning algorithm to the data in order to solve your problem. So we have different algorithms to solve these problems by evaluating the performance of learning system is important, because learning systems are usually designed to predict the class of future unlabeled data points. You can spend a lot of time by choosing, running, or tuning the algorithms. You want to make sure you are using your time effectively to get closer to your goal. And to evaluate the performance of any learning algorithm, we need to consider the parameters. So these parameters are error, accuracy, and precision or recall. So the thing is, whenever you have come up with your data and you are having different types of algorithm, you know your task, you know your goal, for what purpose you are doing this task. Now the thing is, there are different machine learning algorithms. Now you have to choose which algorithm you want to apply onto your data. For that purpose, you have to do the evaluation of algorithms. Which algorithm gives you lesser error, which algorithm gives you more accuracy, and according to precision and recall, that algorithm should be better for your data. So to evaluate the performance of any learning algorithm, we have to consider these three parameters. For the same, all the things are evaluated on the sample. Means we are not applying all the things onto the whole data present with us. We are evaluating on sample only. So this sample contains training set, but as the training set comes with hypothesis, the result we will get may not be accurate. So for this, we need to consider test sets which are disjoint from the training set. We will see one by one what it is. Now see, to evaluate performance of any algorithm, we need to consider these parameters, as I said, and to predict or to tell that these might be outputs of your program or output of your task, we have to evaluate the predictions also. Now the thing is, we have to assume some things here. Okay, so suppose we want to make prediction of a value for a target feature on example x. Now the x is input. Whatever the data set you have prepared before going to choose your learning algorithm, the data set will work as an input and we can call it as a x. Y is the actual output of target feature on example x. Whatever the algorithm you are applying onto the input x, and what will be the actual output you expecting from that algorithm, that actual output is known as y. Y hat is the predicted value on target feature on example x. Y hat is the output given by your algorithm. See, y and y hat are different things. Y is the actual output. Like suppose we are adding two numbers. Numbers are 2 plus 3. Okay. So 2 plus 3 is input now. Y is equal to 5. Okay. Y is equal to 5. What it means? The actual output we are expecting from our algorithm. But as the data set given to the algorithm or algorithm learn some things from the past experiences, it might give answer that 4.8, 4.9, okay? It will not exactly give the answer as a 5, okay? So suppose it is giving the answer like 4.8, okay? So we are considering 4.8 here. So y hat is equal to 4.8. So it is the predicted value on the target feature on example x, okay? So are you getting my point that x is equal to 2 plus 3, y is equal to 5, and y hat is equal to 2.8, suppose. Okay, so y is the actual output we are expecting from the algorithm, but y hat is the output given by the algorithm by learning the things from the data set and from the past experiences. H is the hypothesis. You have come up with your predictions on hypothesis H of X. Okay, now the thing is, what is mean by hypothesis? So hypothesis is a function which is generally used to classify the data, or it might be used for a regression kind of problem. It will come with any kind of problem. Okay, H of X is, this H of X indicates set of hypotheses. Okay, so suppose we have given numbers, and some numbers are positive numbers and some numbers are negative numbers. Then what we have to do? We have to plot that numbers in x and y axis, and we have to differentiate that. So what we have to do is, suppose we are having this is our x axis and this is our y-axis, okay? Suppose we have given some positive points and some negative points, okay? Now the thing is, what is mean by hypothesis? So hypothesis is a function which is used for any specific purpose. Now in this problem, we are having some positive data points, some negative data points, and the thing is, we have to separate these data points, okay? So what I will do, I will draw one line which will see. So this line, if I'm drawing, so this is known as the hypothesis. I can draw this line like this also, okay? I can draw this line like this also. I can draw this line like this also, okay? So these are all possible hypotheses present in this problem. Now H of X is known as all these possible hypotheses. H of X means all possible hypotheses, and in which we are choosing only one hypothesis that will accurately differentiate these data points. Okay, so H of X is all possible hypotheses present in the problem, and H we are choosing such a hypothesis which will differentiate accurately, more accurately, other than all hypotheses. So this is known as H of X, and so this is H of X, we can say, and H is the hypothesis which we have chosen. Okay. So if y hat and y are same, then there is no error, and if they are different, there is an error. Now see, y is equal to 5 and y hat is equal to 4.8. Okay. So if y is equal to 5 and y hat is equal to 5, then there is no error. And if there is difference between them, here the answer is 5 and here the answer is 4.8. So there should be definitely some error. Okay. Now the error is 0.2 here. Okay. So these are some terminologies we have to use while going to evaluate the performance. Okay. Okay. So if there is error, so what type of error it is? Okay, so there are some types of errors. So first one is absolute error. Absolute error. Now you know all the terminologies. H of X is all possible hypothesis we are having. okay? And next one is absolute error. So what we are doing, we are choosing one hypothesis and we are subtracting our actual output from it, okay? So this will give us absolute error. This is for single training example. Suppose we are taking n number of or 10 number of training examples with us and we are calculating the absolute error. So if we are considering for single training example, means we have to use the formula that h of x minus y. If you are having n number of training examples, then you can take the average of it. Means you have to perform for every single training example and you have to take the average, like 1 divided by n summation of all h of x minus y. So absolute error is the average of the differences between original value and the predicted value. Then it gives us the measure of how far the predictions were from the actual output. Now you can see here, as we have taken the example that 2 plus 3 is equal to 5. So our y is equal to 5 and y hat is equal to 4.8. So absolute error will give us how far the predictions, predicted value is 4.8 and actual value is 5. So this type of error or absolute error will give us the measure that how far our prediction is from the actual output. Okay. Next one is sum of squares error. This type of error is actually more important because this will take the average of squares of the difference between original value and predicted value. Actually, this value only we are getting with absolute error, but the advantage of sum of square error is it is easier to compute the gradient, where an absolute error requires complicated linear programming tools to compute the gradient. As we take the squares of error, the effect of larger error becomes more pronounced and than smaller errors. Hence, the model can focus more on larger errors. Now, the thing is, see, what we were doing with absolute error is we were calculating only h of x minus y there, right? And if we are working with n number of models, then there also we were taking the summation, okay? But whatever the error we are getting with single value or single training example, we are taking square of it. And by taking square of all training examples present over present with us, we are taking again summation and we are multiplying it with 1 by n. N is the number of samples you are taking. N is the number of samples you are taking. So this type of error will generally work with larger errors. Okay. Whenever you are having a large amount of data set and in that you have to check whether your actual output is matching with your predicted value, predicted output. So it is not possible, or we should go with the sum of square error because it works with the larger errors, or it will focus more on the larger errors. Next is number of misclassifications. Now the thing is, it is not always possible that your actual output and your predicted output should be same, or there might be very less error present over there. There are some things which we can say are misclassified. Like suppose we are having a basket of red and blue balls, and what we are doing is we are classifying red balls in one bucket and blue balls in one bucket. So while classifying, it may possible that one or two blue balls should go into red balls bucket, or one or two red balls will go with blue balls bucket. Okay, so these are the things which we can say are misclassified things. Okay, so for any data set, there are some misclassifications also possible. If it is not there also, we have to consider it. Okay, so the delta is the function which returns 1 if h of x and y are different, and 0 if they are same. Means h of x is our hypothesis and y is our actual output. Okay, if they are different, means the hypothesis or the line we have drawn to separate the data to classify the data, and after classification or after applying hypothesis, whatever the output we are getting, if there is some error, that means they are definitely different. So delta will return 1 if they are different, and if there is no error, that means they are not different. So at that time, delta will return 0. Okay. So this is used for the classification type of problem, and for classification problem, it is better to represent the confusion matrix. So instead of going with this, we can use one confusion matrix over there. So suppose you are having two class classification problem. One is true class and one is hypothesized class. Means whenever you are having large number of data set present with you, and what you have to do is you have to classify the data, or you are already classified the data, but there are some misclassifications present there. Okay, means some red balls went to the blue bucket and some blue balls went to the red bucket. So there are some misclassifications. So how you are going to calculate that misclassifications? By using this formula. But instead of going to this formula, one more way is there to classify the data or to find out the number of misclassifications present in your data set. Okay, for that you have to use a confusion matrix. Confusion matrix is the matrix which gives us complete performance of the model. Okay. Now the thing is, you have to consider two classes here. We are using this on two class classification. Two class in the same. Just example, we have taken red and blue. So red is one class, blue is one class. Like suppose true class is red class, hypothesized class is blue class. Why we have taken true and hypothesized here? Because true class means the actual output and hypothesized class means predicted output. Whatever our algorithm is giving the output, means true class is 5, hypothesized class is 4.8. Okay. Next thing is, okay, confusion matrix, as the name suggests, gives us a matrix as output and describes the complete performance of the model. For the above example, we have our own classifier which predicts a class for a given input sample. Our on testing our model on 165 samples, we will get following results. Means suppose we are having 165 samples with us, and what we have to do, we have to go with the second image given here. We are having two classes. So first is true class, second is hypothesized class. Both contain some positive values, some negative values. So for true class, we are having positive and negative. For hypothesized, we are having positive and negative. Now the true TP indicates that the cases in which we predicted yes and actual output is also yes. Okay. Okay. So see. What we have to consider here. Okay. So the thing is, in this image, we are seeing true class here, hypothesized class here. For true class, positive and negative it is here, and positive and negative here. What this true positive indicates, whatever the cases we are checking, in that cases, we also predicted the value yes, and the actual output is also yes. That type of samples are known as true positive samples. In our 165 samples, 50 samples are like that. Okay. Next one is true negatives here. True negatives. The cases in which we predicted no and the actual output is also no. So both these values are correct values. True positive and true negative. We also said we, in the sense, our algorithm given value yes, and the actual value is also yes. Means y is yes, y hat is yes. Here y is no, y hat is no. So these values are known as true positive and true negative. Next is false positive, where we predicted yes, but the actual output is no. Algorithm is giving answer as a yes, but the actual output is no. And here, for false negative, we predicted or algorithm is predicting value no, and actual output is yes. That is known as false negative. Okay. So the thing is, see, in our model, we are having total 165 samples, and in this, total 50 true positives are there, total 100 true negatives are there, and 10 false positive and 5 false negative values are. Okay. So what it indicates that instead of going with this formula, you can go with the confusion matrix. So this is little bit simpler than this. For this, what we have to perform is only we have to check every single sample and what will be the output of that sample. Okay. And as the data set created by us only, we know the actual output. We know why all the time. We are just taking Y hat. Okay. So the thing is, see, true positive value is greater, true negative value is greater. What it means, algorithm is working properly. Okay. These values are greater because here also both the values are yes. Here also both the values are no. Both in the sense Y and Y hat is yes, Y and Y hat is no. Here only some samples are there where the actual value and the predicted value are different. So we can say that 80 or 90% accuracy we are achieving by using this algorithm with our samples. So this is known as confusion matrix. So these are four important terms, as I explained, that true positive means the cases in which we predicted yes and the actual output is also yes. The true negative is the cases in which we predicted no, actual output is also no. In false positive, the cases in which we predicted yes and actual output is no. And false negative means the cases in which we predicted no and the actual output is yes. True positive and true negative, that means learning algorithm predicts correct. And false positive and false negative means there are some mistakes of learning algorithm. Okay, so these are the things which we have to consider while writing any confusion matrix. Okay, next thing. Now, by using these things, true positive, true negative, false positive and false negative, we have to write now third parameter. What was the third parameter is precision and recall. Okay, so how to write the precision and recall? So here are the definitions. So first thing is accuracy. It can be calculated by taking average of values lying across the main diagonal. Means true positive plus true negative divided by P plus N. P plus N in the sense all positive and negative values. So now the P plus N is equal to 165 here. Okay. Because 165 is the total number of samples present with us. There might be some positive samples, there might be negative point of samples. So P plus N is total number of samples. In this example, we are having 165 number of samples present with us. So true positive number is with us, true negative number is with us, and P plus N we are having. So by putting the values over here, we can calculate the accuracy given by this algorithm for the problem. Okay. Next one is precision. It is the number of correct positive results divided by number of positive predicted by the classifier. Means what we have to consider here, all the positive results. So positive results we are getting by true positive numbers and divided by number of positive predicted by the classifier. Means in true positive and false positive, both the things classifier is predicting positive value. So for this, we have to consider TP plus EFP, means true positive plus false positive. So it will give you precision. Next one is recall. Recall, it is the number of correct positive results divided by number of all relevant samples. All samples that should have identified as a positive. So here true positive divided by true positive plus False negative. False negative. Why we have taken false negative here? Because false negative are the numbers which are actually the output was yes, but the predicted value was no. So what we have to consider here? All samples that should have been identified as positive. True positive is the actual number of positive values, and false negative values are actually that are positive values, but the classifier or the algorithm saying that these are negative values, but that are actually positive values. So that's why we have considered here false negative. So by putting all the values over here, we can calculate the recall. This we can also call it as a true positive rate. So similarly, we can call it, calculate the false positive rate also. Recall we can say as a true positive rate also. Likewise, we can calculate false positive rate. So false positive rate is defined as FP divided by FP plus TN. What it means that it corresponds to the proportion of negative data points that are mistakenly considered as positive with respect to all negative data points. So first thing is negative data points that are mistakenly considered. So false positive means that are actually negative, but we are considered as a false negative, and divided by false positive, because positive with respect to all negative data points. False positive are also negative data, and true negative actually contains the negative data. So we are dividing this with this, and by putting all the values, we can calculate false positive rate also. Okay, so these are the things. So these are some parameters which we have to use while measuring the performance of any algorithm. Okay, so why to perform this evaluation of machine learning algorithm? Because the thing is, suppose you have generated your data set and you have to apply the algorithm now. Okay, suppose you want to classify something like red and blue balls. Okay, so what our problem is to classify red and blue balls in different baskets. Now what is the data set we are creating? Suppose we are having 40 number of red balls, 50 number of blue balls. So the total 90 data set we have created here. Okay, now to classify the data, we are having different types of algorithms. Okay, different classifiers are there. Now the thing is, which algorithm will be best to classify these red and blue balls? Okay, for that you have to evaluate the performance of all the algorithms. So how you will evaluate that? By using these three parameters: error, accuracy, and precision or recall. Okay, so how the error is calculated? For that you have to use these terminologies. Errors are basically of two types: absolute error and sum of squares error. By using that, means if your y and y hat does not contain any means they are not different from one another, it means that there is no error. But if they are differing from one another, it means there is some error. Minor errors are considered, but if there is a huge error, so it will be a problem of your either data set or your algorithm or classifier you are using. Next is a number of misclassifications. So while classifying your data, there are some misclassification might possible. So instead of going to this formula, you can go for the confusion matrix. So the confusion matrix is represented like this here. So for two class problems, we are using the confusion matrix like this. Everything is having their own definition, and according to the definition, you have to put the values here by choosing one samples and working onto the samples, and then you will get some values. And after that, after getting the values of all the fields of confusion matrix, you can calculate the accuracy, you can calculate the precision, you can calculate the recall. Recall is also known as true positive rate, and next one is the false positive rate. by considering all these things, you can choose. Now, all these parameters you have to check for all three or four algorithms which will classify your red and blue balls. And whenever you got more accuracy, more precision, and less recall, then you have to choose such algorithm to classify your red and blue balls. So this is the overall intention of evaluation of performance of any learning algorithm. Okay. Next thing is cross-validation. So what is mean by cross-validation? So in machine learning, we couldn't fit the model on training data and can't say that model will work accurately for real data. For this, we must assure that our model got correct patterns from the data and it is not getting too much noise. Means before some time we have said that we are having total 165 number of samples in one problem. Okay. So every time it is not possible that you should go for every single samples and you have to check all the samples and for every algorithm you are providing single samples. Okay. So for that purpose you have to use the cross validation technique. So this technique in which we train our model using the subset of data set and then evaluate using the complementary subset of the data set. Okay. So basically three steps are involved into it. First one is reserve some portion of sample data set. Using the rest data set, train the model and test the model using the reserve portion of the data set. Okay, we will see one by one. Okay. So this method is also known as k-fold cross-validation. In this method, we split the data set into k number of subsets, then we perform training on all subsets by leaving one subset for the evaluation of trained model, and we iterate k times with the different subsets reserved for the testing purpose each time, and k number of rounds to perform. See here. So we have taken one example. Suppose we are having five instances present or five samples present in one dataset. Okay. So what we have to do in cross-validation is, in first iteration, we choose four instances for training and one for evaluation, that means testing. Now the thing is, see, this is total data set present with us. We are making it as a five instances. Now the thing is, whatever the thing we have to perform, we will perform first onto the fifth instance. Now the fifth instance is known as evaluation or testing instance, and all the four instances are known as training instance. So whatever algorithm we are performing, like suppose fifth instance contains some red balls and some blue balls, so we are performing testing here. We are segregating or we are differentiating red balls and blue balls from fifth instance only, and these four instances are training. Four instances are taking training from the fifth instance. Okay. Now we have segregated all the red and blue balls in different buckets from fifth instance only. Now for second iteration, we will go for fourth number of sample or fourth number of instance. Now the training instances are 1, 2, 3, and 5. And from fourth instance, we are using it as a evaluation or testing instance. Now this also contains some red balls, some blue balls. Now we are segregating or we are differentiating all the red and blue balls in different buckets. Here we are performing our algorithm, and these four are the instances. These are learning from this algorithm. In third iteration, we will use 1, 2, 4, and 5 as a training and 3 as a testing, where we can perform the segregation. In fourth instance, we will use 1, 3, 4, 5 as a training instances and 2 as a testing instance. Here we will perform the differentiation between all the red and blue balls. In fifth instance, we will use 2, 3, 4, 5 as a training instance and 1 will be the testing instance. So from first instance or first sample, we will differentiate all the red and blue balls by one another in different baskets. So why we have to use this cross validation technique is when we have to go for the measuring the performance, then we have to use number of instances. So it is not possible to work on all the data at one time, or it will not be feasible also. It will not give us accurate result also. So for this, we are using k-fold cross validation technique, in which k is equal to number of instances you are having. Now the instances we are having is 5 in this problem, so k is equal to 5 now. And what we have to do is we have to minimize one instance every time, and that one instance is known as testing instance, and all other instances are known as training instance. Whatever the algorithm we have to apply, we have to apply it onto the testing instance. And for every iteration, we have to take new instance as a testing instance. So there should be k number of iterations present in this problem. Now the k is equal to 5, means 5 number of instances present in this problem. So 5 number of iterations are possible in this problem. Likewise, we are working or we are applying the algorithm one by one on all the instances, so that it will increase the accuracy also. And as we are increasing the instances, as we are increasing the iterations, instances will learn more from all the iterations. So there is possibility of accurate result from it. Okay. So this technique is known as k-fold cross validation technique. Okay. So what we have to do is k number of subsets, then we have to perform training on all subsets. By leaving one subset for the evaluation of trained model, we iterate k times with a different subset reserved for testing purpose each time. Means every time we are reserving one instance as a testing instance, and k number of rounds are there. So this is the thing, or this is the example for cross validation. Okay, so training set is to train the learner. Testing and evaluation is to test the learner. After completion of all entire trainings, you can check the accuracy, and the output is average error. And after every round, we are getting validation accuracy, and the final accuracy we are getting is an average of all the rounds. Means for every time we are getting some accuracy here. And accuracy in the sense, suppose we are considering fifth number of instance, and there are 10 red balls and 10 blue balls are there. So we are differentiating, we are segregating that balls. So suppose in red bucket we have put 9 balls, and in blue bucket we have put 11 balls. So there is some error, because we know that there are 10 red balls and there are 10 blue balls, but we have kept, or algorithm have kept 9 balls in red bucket and 11 balls in blue bucket. So there is some error. Okay, so here we are getting the error also, we are getting the accuracy also. So might be accuracy is of 95%. In second iteration, suppose in fourth instance, there are 10 red balls and 10 blue balls, and it will classify like 10 balls it will put onto the red bucket, 10 balls it will put onto the blue bucket. So 100% accuracy we have achieved here, there is no error into it. So every time we are getting some accuracy here, and the final accuracy is calculated by taking average of all the rounds, of average of accuracy of all the rounds. Okay, so here also by using k-fold cross validation, we can check whether any algorithm contains any error, or what is the accuracy of that algorithm on the data we have presented for that algorithm. Okay, thank you.